this gift of today. We thank you for the gift of our lives, for the gift of our relationships, and especially for those who are married, for the gift of marriage. And just ask you, Lord, to send down your spirit in abundance upon all who are gathered here. Give me the words to speak which you wish me to speak. Give those the ears to hear the message which you wish them to hear. And as we come to a greater appreciation of the sacrament of marriage, help us all, Lord, to see where you're speaking to us and acting in our lives, encouraging us to deeper and more profound relationships with our loved ones. We ask all this through Christ our Lord. Amen. In the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right. Welcome back to the second of our series in the theology of marriage. And so what we're going to talk about today is two things. It's male and female from a scriptural perspective, but also in order to understand that, you have to understand what is commonly referred to today in modern psychology as emotional or affective intelligence, in correlation also with regular intelligence. We have an old kind of colloquial saying about putting this is how we'll oftentimes speak of this is the heart and the head. And which one do you kind of fall into? If you were actually to take a Myers-Briggs test, which is oftentimes tests that will be used in the workplace to help with interpersonal relations, one of the things that the Myers-Briggs will sometimes talk about is if you're an F or a T, a feeler or a thinker. Again, most of the personality testing will usually go into that. Is a person more analytical, more left side of the brain, or is a person more kind of creative on the right side of the brain? It's kind of that imaginative. So if you look at the heart and the head, what I would say is that although there's no moral quality to being more of a heart person or more of a head person, you can say, why does this exist? Is this actually a good thing? Because although I would say that it's not necessarily has no morality to it, but there is the question of why does this kind of seem to be a separation which oftentimes separates many people, which is people who don't understand the feelings of other people or people who don't understand the thought processes of other people. And so actually, you can say that this dichotomy, this separation, I mean, anytime that you see separation, especially separation, real separation that causes conflict, we see this in the church as being not a sign of God's presence, but actually a sign of disunity. And it's oftentimes going to be a consequence of the fall. And actually, if you were to look at the consequences of the fall, is anyone familiar with the three consequences of the fall? Like when Adam and Eve sinned, and everyone now, I actually asked my teenagers this session, they're like, well, they're kicked out of the garden. I said, yes, that's what happens. I said, but what's the long-term effects of when Adam and Eve choose to disobey God? Well, there's three. First one is that they no longer see in a proper relationship with God. Okay. Second effect of the fall is that they're no longer in proper relationship with one another. Okay, now that you have the beginning of the battle of the sexes, which is what we're going to be talking about a little bit today, or apples to apples, if you ever played that game. Okay, the first beginning of the battle of the sexes, and likewise of people stepping on top of each other and trying to be supreme over one another, because if everyone is like God, there's only one God at the top. So there's going to be problems in relationship. And then the third, if you're no longer in relationship, and what is dependent upon your relationship, being in right relationship, is that you are able to perform together a role, that role will no longer be possible. And the role of Adam and Eve was to be mutual gardeners of the planet, right? They had dominion over all things. And so that third effect of the fall will also suffer, which is the consequence that their relationship with the world, the relationship with the planet will also suffer, and actually the land will cry out against them. Triple effect of the fall. But go back to that first effect of the fall. No longer are they in proper relationship with God. Can you guys hear me? Still? Okay. No longer are they in proper relationship with God. Well, see, God is not something which exists or who exists just externally from ourselves. God also exists and wants and desires to exist internally. So when Adam and Eve are no longer in proper relationship with God, they also don't understand God. They also don't understand themselves, because there's a key part of themselves that they can only understand if they're in relationship with Him. Actually, when they fall out of relationship with God, they have the beginnings of the first internal dissidence, or the first of internal anxiety, the first of internal separation, the first of internal what? Internal strife, internal conflict, all those internal things that begin that cause us to suffer, not because of what other people are doing, but those internal things that we suffer from. This is a consequence of the fall, because we no longer see and behold the face of God, it will affect us. Does this make sense? So what you can say is also this very ancient understanding of what people who are of the heart, this is what Ezekiel talks about, of the heart, but also of the head. God speaks in very rational ways, and actually the wisdom literature, if you read the wisdom literature, Proverbs, the wisdom of Solomon, it'll be very, what, little short wise sayings that you can reflect upon and ponder with your head. Again, wisdom is oftentimes talked about, and it talks about beware of passions. But on the other hand, it says, what, I want passions. It's weird if you look at the scripture in terms of heart and head language. And both will be used at various times. Because what I would say is that this separation, this dichotomy, this where we experience a lot of problems, not only in our own lives, but also especially in our interpersonal relationships, and it can be also with our spouses, is not actually necessarily a good thing. What Jesus comes to do is to actually to reintegrate us within ourselves. He actually comes to heal this division so that we don't have to just be heart people and we don't just have to be head people. We can be people of our heart and of our head, having a proper balance, a proper relationship. Because this is not just a psychological problem. This is a spiritual problem. All psychological maladies, all physical maladies, all consequences of the fall, what, disease, any type of diseases, was understood by the ancient Jews to be a consequence of the fall. And this is one of them. It's actually one of the greatest ones because it's one of the ones which we experience most internally. So when you look at relationships, this is what I often tell my high schoolers. I'm like, men oftentimes can struggle with articulating their emotional selves, right? Do they want to have teenage boys or remember being a teenage boy and trying to get a teenage boy to talk about their feelings? This is George Carlin. He says, all women are crazy and all men are stupid. And the reason that all women are crazy is because all men are stupid. Okay? So, what men oftentimes, and this is true of high schoolers, and this can also be true of older men, although it can be true of women, but I would say this. This is also something which some people are saying, well, masculinity and femininity are culturally assigned. Like, culture dictates masculine roles and feminine roles and what masculinity is and what it is not. That's a very popular common argument. Well, they've done studies on boys and girls across the planet to see that this was actually true. One study that they did actually did a study on children before they became aware of their cultural differences. So children of the age of between 2 and 3, they did this study. Children in Oceania, in Australia, people in Asia, people in South America, North America, Europe, and Africa. And in this study, they put 30 different objects in front of all these different groups of small 2 and 3-year-olds. So were they affected at some point by culture? Yes. But to the degree that they're really cognizant or aware of it and things like that, where it's really going to start affecting them? No. That's why actually if you put 2 or 3-year-old children together of different cultures, they don't look at skin color, they don't look at things like that. They overlook them. They're not aware of the culture. So they can't be really that much aware of what femininity and masculinity roles within the culture at that point. It was interesting, though, in this particular study, as it was trying to evaluate, are there any things which are distinctively feminine that we can find and demonstrate from young children? And what they found is that all these 30 objects that they put, 20-30 objects in front of these little kids, the little girls, in the age of 2 and 3, all gravitated towards the doll-like figure. Not all of them, but for the vast majority, all of them towards that figure that they could actually hold and cuddle. Okay, all of the little boys, for the most part, gravitated towards that object which they could pick up and use as a weapon. Okay, and hit each other with. Okay, so what? Now, is this absolute proof? No, but it does demonstrate something that even on a psychological, emotional level, because for the most part, little 2-3-year-olds don't have a lot of profound thoughts. I refer to 2 or 3-year-olds as kind of bundles of feelings, okay? But what? There's something which they gravitate towards. So within looking then that, oftentimes some people, and this can be true of women too, I think that may be one of the reasons I'm not, because I was raised in a house of 6 women, so I had to develop this, and so anyone can develop it. It's not just like women are better emotionally than men. Men have a great emotional capacity, but because of one thing in particular that women have that men don't, they also did a recent study on, and this was kind of funny one I thought, was on children in utero. They've actually done studies on children, females in utero. This one study showed that actually some females' mouths are already starting to move at 7 months in the womb. And they've never found the male mouth ever really moving. Okay? Now, there's also been studies done on men and women that men, average men, will speak 5,000 words per day. average women will speak 20,000 words per day. Okay? Big difference. And that's why, like, men sometimes get overwhelmed with women, just like, you're talking too much. We also know from brain scans and things like this, is that the brain scans of men and women are very different. They've done brain scans on many women, and most women actually, even while sleeping, their brain is in constant activity. The electrical activity is overwhelming, even when they're in a restful state. Men, throughout the day, actually go into actually moments of periodic hibernation. Their brains actually start hibernating at periodic moments throughout the day. Where, like, then the females will sometimes turn to the male and they'll say, "What are you thinking?" He's like, "None." She's like, "No, you were thinking about something." And he's like, "No." It's actually true. Sometimes men's brains actually go into periodic hibernation throughout the day. At least some studies have shown that. What? There's a big difference. Some people want to say that masculinity and femininity are only assigned by biology. There's also a big emotional difference. If you've ever been on a men's chirp, I can tell you this. Men's chirp, guys, is very different than women's chirp. Women, men's chirp is very different. Why? Because for the most part, if you put a bunch of women in a room together, and some of this is cultural, but some of it is not, because you can put this across. I've been in groups all across the world. I've been in Europe. I've been in, again, South America with women. I've been in North America. If you put a bunch of women into a room together, they are going to act amongst themselves very differently than you put a bunch of men into a room together. For the most part, women will almost immediately start talking about their personal lives, their personal relationships. Again, this is actually one of the things which is one of the greatest causes of pain for many women, especially in middle school, when all the girls are talking about the other relationships or comparing other people and things like this. They talk a lot, especially about relationships and things like that. Men, you put them into a room together, and the first thing that they will talk about is usually either sports, jobs, or they'll make sex jokes, right? We all know that, guys. That's what we do. That's what the guys do. Very rarely, though, they'll talk about sex, but very rarely will they talk about their intimate lives, what's really going on in their relationships. That is almost taboo to really talk about that. Maybe with one or two of your friends, but that's about it. And actually, probably not even that. Women, though, what I've come to discover, and I have six sisters, as well as women have no problem talking about their intimate. They don't make the same type of jokes that men do, typically. But they will talk about all the details, much more so than actually men are sometimes even comfortable with. Does this make sense? So what is this going to? Women develop a language aptitude, and some of this is cultural, but some of it is also part of it. Women develop a language aptitude. They've done studies also on education and on the causes of poverty in the world. Now, a lot of sociologists, again, a lot of anthropologists and things like this have done studies on why does poverty exist in the world? Well, most people will say the reason that poverty exists is because of poor education. People who are highly educated tend to do well in the world. People who are lowly don't have very much education. They tend to do poorly and they stay stuck in bad social situations. But see, that's not really 100% honest. Because if you know anything about sociology, you know anything about a lot of these studies, what they also come to discover is that one of the main reasons why children are not interested in education and rising to a better station in life is because children who are raised in poor or broken family structures are not interested in being educated. So, and actually because of financial instability at the lowest social rungs, many of those children are coming from broken or likewise very hostile or aggressive homes where there's a lot of financial troubles. Financial troubles place a lot of stress on couples, as probably some of you know. You're at the lowest social rung and you're living beyond your means, which is especially prevalent in the United States. It causes a lot of stress, which causes a lot of breakups in families. And so actually children who are members of those families oftentimes will, on an emotional level as well as on just the family structure level, they're not interested in school unless they are, again, an exceptional child. But for many times, that's why people have been looking at, it's why one of the common theories today that people are trying to advance is this idea, well, it's not a family who raises a child, it's a village that raises a child. You guys heard this before? Okay. Now, see, that goes in contradiction to our understanding. We say that a village supports the raising of a child, but it's not a village who raises a child. It's a mother and a father. Actually, children need mothers and fathers. They need also the extended community, the extended family and things like this, but it's the mother and the father. Even if a child is entrusted to the state and things like that, and we've seen things like this, it's called orphanages or different life programs. We can make it, try to make the best program at all. Children still have self-identity issues. They feel abandonment. Okay? If you look at just, again, psychology and things like that, children feel and experience abandonment. I didn't have my father. I didn't know my mother. Whatever it may be. Okay? Family problems are actually the main cause of prolonged poverty. Okay? That's why there's been also a lot of work. They realize we can't just, we can try to throw, and that's what we've been doing for a long time, throwing more and more education at this issue, but it's not solving the problem, because the problem exists on the level of family units. It's also why there's been a recent move to try to redefine, well, let's just redefine the family unit. The problem is, when you redefine the family unit and you change it, it doesn't necessarily change the problem. You actually only possibly create more problems. Because I'll tell you this, one of the most important things that parents teach to their children is what is a healthy relationship between two different, very different individuals look like. Because if you have two of the same individuals, two persons of the same gender, they don't teach necessarily that what differences don't have to disunite. Now obviously, if you have two persons who are doing this, who are disuniting, it's causing problems as well. But see, what ideally a male and a female, a mother and a father, can teach their children without even doing it is what? That differences are actually beautiful. They can actually unite us. When sin enters the picture, it screws everything up. That's actually one of the most important things. It's also that what? That both sexes love you. Right? Both sexes are interested in you. Both sexes, both all women, who for the child, all women are summed up in their mother, and for the child, all what men are summed up in their father. Both sexes value and cherish and love you. So that's something which is profound, for especially for even, now does a child understand this at the time? No. But do developmental and likewise psychological things develop after the fact if they don't have access to a father's love and access to a mother's love? Some people are like, well, just give them two. Two is not the same because there is a difference between the two. Does this make sense? So in looking at that, it's also going back to one of the reasons why women, oftentimes I would say, are actually usually, typically speaking, initially more emotionally intelligent is because they have the language. Most children from the lowest economic levels, usually their parents usually don't have good language skills, or they have very poor communication skills because of the stress and things like that, and because of poor education. The average child who comes into the educational system has about, from those lowest rungs, unless there is an extraordinary healthy family structure, but very often those children coming from the lowest social levels where there's a lot of family instability have about a language vocabulary of 3,000 words. Okay, it's also why we say what vulgar speech, like where you find vulgar speech in the vulgar tongue. Vulgar just means base. It's like, but people who use like carnal language to express themselves. So like when people who use the F word, for instance, and it means a noun, a verb, an adjective, it basically is like every other word. Okay, but what's the problem with that? Apart from just being like offensive to our ears, the problem with it is that it's inarticulate. It doesn't express really anything. It expresses anger or frustration, whatever it is you're trying to get to. But it's not really articulate. It doesn't express anything. And actually, for children who are picking up on this, it doesn't teach them how to express themselves. That's why vulgar language and base and carnal language actually does have developmental problems and causes developmental problems with the person. It also causes, obviously, problems in the relationship between the spouses. But most children coming from those lowest levels, or many of them, will have about a language vocabulary of about 3,000 words. The average child coming from a healthy family structure, more often than not from a higher economics standpoint, has a language vocabulary of about 5,000 words. And you might think, okay, well, it's not that big of a difference. If the child with 3,000 words does twice as much work, and let's say that they're extraordinarily gifted, and they do twice as much work, by the time that they've gotten to 7,500 words, the other child is already at 9,000. There's always a disparity in language, in reading, in comprehension. It will cause problems. Maybe they're blessed in math and things like this, where maybe they can grab onto that. Many of them actually, especially if they're more of the creative side, more of right brain, which is much more of a literature and stories and things like that, they're always going to what? Be behind. which is actually only going to cause more problems with their self-identity problems, because they're always going to be the stupid one. It's not that they're stupid. That's the thing. Many of them, they get made fun of as being stupid and behind, that they can't pass. They're the ones who are getting the C's or the D's and things like that, or they're held back a grade. But there's what? It goes to language. A lot of it goes to language. Does this make sense? So what does this have to do with male and female? Well, women, because language-wise, and especially emotionally-wise, they develop what an aptitude towards language, oftentimes very on. It can be very painful in middle school, but it's actually very helpful later on. It's also why women, typically speaking, especially in high school, think about all the high school guys. They were all idiots and jerks. And what? Women do, emotionally speaking, develop 2 years on average faster than men. What? Women are usually developed by 12, between the years of 12 and 14, guys on the age between 16 and 18. So women are always actually, if you're staying in your same grade level, women, typically speaking, are working with a person who is not fully developed yet. It takes longer to develop. And it's not that he will never develop. Well, sometimes he doesn't, but he can develop, but it takes what? It takes effort, takes work. It also takes someone who's teaching him, hopefully a good father, a good relationship with the mother. If these things are not present, it can be very difficult. But so, what? Many men, especially many high schoolers, and now women, by the age of like 10 years old, are oftentimes able to articulate what's going on. That's why they'll read poetry. They'll read all these things to try to articulate and do things like that. That's why little boys like look at their little girl counterparts and they're like, you're weird and all things like that. It's like, well, you like poetry, you like all these weird things. What? But they're articulate. They're able to articulate what's going on because they've developed a language which they have developed in the context of friendships with persons of their same sex. So when you look at, say that there are oftentimes with many males, and this can be true of a 50-year-old male as well, although hopefully he grows out of it, is that what I refer to as the four basic male emotions. Happy, sad, angry, do you know what the last one is? Horny. The basic four male emotions. Now, for a small child, this is fine, but even with small child, we have those little smiley face charts in doctor's offices to try to help them identify the deeper thing that's going on, right? So you have these little things to help them understand what it is, because if you get the wrong diagnosis for the wrong thing, you're going to have a problem. You have to have the right diagnosis for what you're dealing with. And the same thing is true when you're expressing yourself emotionally, because not all feelings are the same. When you express yourself in one of these ways, this expresses almost nothing. This expresses what a 3 or 4-year-old can express. And I'm not saying that men, even high schoolers, only have these, but for the most part, in terms of the language, they have much fewer words to express themselves than many girls. Because the difference between happy and some of the other ones, women more oftentimes aware of that interior emotional self and emotional, will actually draw this out of men. It's one of the reasons why actually men will gravitate towards women at a certain time. Not usually before the age of what? Puberty. But after they've started to awaken to deeper realities, that there is deeper things going on that they want to understand, they'll gravitate oftentimes towards females. And in that, they awaken, something awakens within them, then happy becomes what? Joyful. Joyful, though, is very different than peaceful. Because a sense of joy is something that you can be very unhappy and still have a sense of joy. Everything is all right. Very different, though. That's kind of an uplifting spirit. Joy has to do with your mission and purpose. Mission and purpose in life. If you have mission and purpose, things go well. If you feel like you have no mission and purpose, you have no real joy. Versus peace, which has to do with internal stability. Like all of a sudden things are unstable. If things are unstable, you will not be in a sense of peace. Of course, many people will just say, well, I'm happy. What does that mean? Are you peaceful? Are you joyful? Again, if you look at content, many people will say, well, I'm content with how things are. Content is actually not a good feeling. We should never be content. Why? Because when you become content, you more often than not are being mediocre. I'm content. I want things to stay the same. See, we're called to be human beings. We are called to be in constant movement, constant relationship, moving, growing. People who become content are usually not growing. Behind content is sometimes, oftentimes, the sin of laziness or sloth or neglect. I'm content in our relationship. I don't want it to change. Right? I'm content with how things are going. Now, that's a little bit different than being satisfied. We should be satisfied with our relationship, satisfied with what God's given us, joyful and grateful for that. But should we be content C.S. Lewis says this about God: it's very easy to please God. It's very difficult to satisfy him. Again, God is never content with us. Why? Because he wants us always to grow. Is that a bad thing? So if you are not content with your spouse, or your spouse is not content with you, then that is actually a good thing. That means that, you are growing, or that you have an opportunity for growth. People who become content end up in stagnant relationships. It's like a swamp. And if you know anything about a swamp, swamps are filled with a lot of dead things. It can seem like it's peaceful. It seems like it's peaceful because there's no movement. There's no movement in a swamp either because things are dead. Very different than peaceful. Peaceful is where it's like serene waters on the sea, but the sea is always moving, versus a swamp where it's just stagnant and dead. Very different, though. And if you actually examine the emotional self, you can usually figure out which one you're dealing with. Am I just content, and I don't, therefore, when I'm challenged, do I get angry? Because a person who's content with things and then they get challenged, they get angry. Versus a person who is satisfied, when they're challenged with something, they're excited to grow. Does this make sense? So content, elated. Elated is something which is, again, those momentary elations that we get throughout the day. Elations usually almost always come about from some interior reality of something which is exterior to ourselves. Someone gives you a good review at work. You have a sense of elation. Again, you have some type of things like this. Elation, though, very different than being pleased. Like, I'm pleased with you. Okay, so that means we're good. No, we're not good. Okay, pleased is like a building block where we rebuild trust. You violated trust. And no, I don't 100% trust you, but if you give me enough pleasing moments, moments where you can please, this time you can slowly rebuild the foundation of trust, which has been destroyed. That's like some people are like, well, I did this for you. We should be okay now. No. You guys know situations like this? Where people's expectation of trust is it's like a one-time moment. It was one-time moment lost. It's one-time moment rebuilt. No, trust once lost has to take many moments of what? Pleasing encounters, because you had a very unpleasing encounter, which destroyed the trust. So people whose expectation that trust is going to be rebuilt overnight are oftentimes it's inordinate and it's not a rational understanding. I'm overwhelmed with the experience. I'm overwhelmed with what's going on. I'm happy. Well, I'm happy. No. Well, what's really going on? See, to express these things takes a little bit more honesty and self-awareness. Going back to last class, honesty, self-awareness, vulnerability, these things take a little bit more honesty as well as self-awareness, digging through what are we actually experiencing. Keep going on, I'm satisfied with the relationship versus I'm ecstatic with what's going on. Ecstatic is, again, something which is actually deep, spiritual. The ecstasy of St. Teresa of Avila, when she went into ecstasy, this is an encounter with what? Something just beyond something which is a elated moment. Elations are just kind of blips on the radar, nice little things that happen. Versus ecstasia, ecstatic moments are moments where we are drawn out of ourselves into a timelessness. It's one of the reasons why we like ecstasy. If you've ever experienced it. But ecstasy is a wonderful experience because there's a timelessness to it. It's an entering into the spiritual where there is no time. So these are just a few examples of things which are going on. What? Because some of them, in terms of duration, some of them are blips, some of them are long-standing, some of them are slowly rising or slowly falling. In terms of where they're coming from, some are coming from internal reality, internal things. Some of them are caused by external. All these ways in which we can actually evaluate in almost a scientific way what is going on the affect. This is actually what Ignatian spirituality calls the examine. The examine is where you process your deep feelings, not just your deep thoughts, which a lot of people think it is. You process your deepest feelings throughout the day and see what's going on. Same thing is true with sad, depressed. I'm depressed. Now, if you say I'm depressed with you, okay, not only is it unkind, but it's actually untrue. Depression is never caused from an external source. Depression is always caused by an internal source, an internal dissidence, something internally going wrong. So you do not find external things depressing, although many people will express themselves in that way. What you find is external things distressing. Right, we have different language, and some people are like, well, you're just playing semantics. And no, we have different words because different words express different things. If I have a car coming at me at 100 miles an hour, it doesn't cause me to become depressed. Okay, I'm very distressed that I'm about to die. Okay, but my distress is about to be over if I get hit. Okay, depression is long-term. It's long-standing. Okay, it goes on for long periods of time. And actually depression, distress comes from external reality and is for the most part not spiritual. You don't find really things like this to really, if you are rooted in your spirituality, you don't find things to really be distressing of an external reality. Internal things, yes. External things in spirituality, no. Why? Because distression oftentimes has to do with relationships, external relationships in the world, or external things going on. Depression comes from something internal. It's actually, for the most part, many people think that depression is a psychological problem. Depression, for the most part, it can have some biological connections in terms of chemicals and things like that, but it's actually, for the most part, a spiritual problem. People who have no God, who they can say thank you to. That was actually one of the things that Chesterton said. Chesterton, a journalist in the 1920s, he said, the greatest thing about having God, the saddest thing about an atheist or an agnostic is that they have no one to be grateful to. So they have actually no way of experiencing constant gratitude throughout the day, which is where joy comes from. But a person who has no connection to God, or maybe they do have a connection to God, but it's not developed and fleshed out. And they need to develop, because where they are in life, they need a developed and fleshed out relationship with God who can answer the question of, why am I here? Who am I? See, if you know the face of God, you know who you are. You are his beloved son or daughter. And you know why I'm here. I'm here to experience and to give love, which gives you meaning and purpose. But people who have no relationship with God are much more likely to get depressed because they don't what? It's the first effect of the fall. Does this make sense? Now, long-term spiritual problems can actually manifest themselves in a physical way. And once you have a physical problem, you have to take your medicine. Okay, or once people, again, for any number of reasons, PTSD and things like this can cause distressing things. If they're not understood and processed, they can actually cause long-term depression and things like that. And so you have to look to the root cause of what's causing it. But many times, and this is where secular psychology can't answer the question. If you have a spiritual problem, it's going to manifest itself, and psychology can't always take care of it. But God can. Because if we have actually a need for God and you don't satisfy the need for the infinite, that will have consequences, internal ones. Okay? So likewise, distress, grieving. Grief is very interesting because grief is, for the most part, an animal thing. Animals, we experience grief. You see it in nature. Not for the long-standing effect that human beings do, but human beings grieve, and that's why you have the five stages of grief to understand walking through the grief process. Grief is very different than desolate. A sense of desolation is like, if you think about a desolate desert, desolation is dryness. It's when everything internally feels dry. It's just like, you get, like you go to Mass, and it's just dry. It doesn't feel, you don't get anything. Grieving is like wet, right? That's why it's accompanied usually by wet tears. Right, lots of tears, lots of anger, lots of passion, lots of whatever it may be. But see, desolation is oftentimes accompanied by almost no feeling. Or it's actually the absence of feeling, the drying up, the sucking away of feeling. Does this make sense? Desolation is actually an internal reality which comes from usually a lack of feeding water to the soul. If you don't give water to yourself, spiritual water, that's why Jesus calls the woman at the well, let me give you water. You will find yourself desolate. And there's actually many reasons. I have a whole class on why people have experienced desolation, a dryness in prayer. But very different than grief. But people who equate grief and desolation to the same thing, the way you solve grief is very different than the way you solve desolation. Grief is solved by time, sometimes by counseling, by relationship things, by looking at the relationship, which is of grief is always of something lost. But desolation is caused by the loss of God. The way you solve it is going to be very different. Starting point's different. Ending point, the medication is different. Does this make sense? Likewise, a person is miserable. I love when I hear people say, you make me miserable. That's not true. Misery is about the way in which I process and internalize external realities internally. Right? So it does have to do, it's a little bit different than the spiritual one of depression and things like that, because depression is more about an internal misunderstanding and things like that, or whatever it may be. But misery does have actually parts of where it's about external reality and external relationships, and they can make us miserable, but they don't have to if you process and you understand and things like this. But if people who don't do this will oftentimes be in states of misery, but the problem is the misery is not caused by the other person. The misery is caused by themselves. They are their own cause of misery. Or sometimes people stay in situations which make them miserable when they actually have alternatives out. Okay, but they don't want to make the change. They're content, actually, to a certain extent. They become content with just like the suckiness of life. And they're just like, well, it's always going to be this way. No, and then people point out to them, no, it doesn't have to be this way. There's this, 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 this. They're like, but I don't want to do that. Why? Because they're content. To a certain extent, in spite of their misery, they become content. Does this make sense? So misery is very different than heartbroken, though. Because heartbroken is actually just an experience of loss. Jesus becomes heartbroken. I wouldn't say that Jesus actually ever experiences like that misery. Especially misery for self, which my mother called the woe-woe parties. Woe, woe is me. Jesus never is woe, woe is me. If Jesus experiences woe, it's always woe, woe is you. Right? It's always misery pointing out. Again, he points it outward. But heartbroken, Jesus gets heartbroken when he's misunderstood. Jesus gets heartbroken when people are suffering needlessly and things like this. Heartbroken is something which is actually a good thing, which we experience when we see things are going wrong. Very much connected to sorrow. Sorrow is never for the self. Sorrow is when we turn on the TV and we see things that are going on and that we actually allow the feeling to envelop us where we want to do something. See, if you don't want to do anything, that's not real sorrow. Sorrow is always has this impulse to change the situation. Okay? So sorrow, very different than dejected. Dejected is something, sorrow is about when we encounter things in the external world, oftentimes that we're helpless and we're unable to do anything about. Mary experienced sorrow. What? Sorrow is oftentimes accompanied by helplessness. That's why many people don't like sorrow, because they don't like to be helpless. They don't like to recognize they can do nothing. Mary at the foot of the cross can do nothing except be there. And so she's doing what she can. But can she change the situation? No. Okay? Different than dejection. Dejection is something about something you can change, but it's oftentimes a momentary setback when you get a bad review at work, where someone says something which you thought was unkind. Dejection, again, different than rejection or being alone. Dejection is like someone did something to you, but it's not really deep. It's shallow. It's superficial. You get dejected. A momentary setback, right? Versus rejection is when you reject part of the other person, or you have experienced something that this person rejected me. Okay. Now, you use the wrong word, you're going to have problems. Because when you reject someone, you reject part of who they are. Versus dejection is just that something bad happened, and that there was no actually rejection there. But what rejection, now sometimes there's actually a good reason why people reject one another. Because people who self-identify with their sin, and they say that this sin is a part of me, and you therefore to accept me, you have to accept me, or otherwise you reject me. I can reject a person's sin. Jesus demands that we reject people's sins because we don't say that people are equal to their sins. So actually, we are called at times to reject. So like a person will share something and their spouse will get upset and they'll say no. And they're like, you're rejecting me. That's right, I am rejecting you because this is not a part of you. You are more than this. Or you could have done, you didn't have to fall into this particular sin. Why are you being so mean? No, I'm rejecting the sin. I'm loving you. But if a person's sharing part of their story, a person's just trying to share part of their heart, and they're trying to explore and get to the bottom of things, and then a person's just like, I don't want to listen to that. That's rejection of the person. So then the question becomes, what's being rejected? Is it being rejected a sin, or is what's being rejected a part of the person? Because if you reject part of the person, it will entail horrible, horrible suffering. Does this make sense? But it's also why morality is so important. Because how do you know what is part of the person, what is not? Anything which is immoral is not a part of the person. It is a parasite. Right? And you can reject parasites. Sin is parasitical by nature. That's why St. Augustine calls sin the corruption of a good. So when you look at that, many people, though, when they get sad, what they're actually really feeling is loneliness or feeling alone. And actually, a person who has not experienced God will feel very alone. See, now it's not just companionship, because you can desire companionship, but companionship is very different than this sense of loneliness, because you can be right next to your companion, and you can still feel alone. If you go to your companion in those times of loneliness, you actually are trying to fill your caving cavity of God with your person. and you will burn them out. It's actually not good to communicate in times of severe loneliness. And many times the reason why severe loneliness continues on is because people do not pray. If you do not pray, you will become more and more lonely. Actually, if you look at your feelings can actually be triggers for knowing when you need to encounter God. If that makes sense. Many people who don't understand or don't like God or don't believe in God and things like that, doesn't mean that those feelings and those indications and those problems, those symptomatic problems are going to go away. They just won't be able to have the medicine of the soul which they need. Does this make sense? So again, the question is, what type of loneliness am I feeling? Just a companionship? I want people? Or am I feeling this like I'm lying in bed next to my spouse and I'm alone? Why am I feeling alone? Because you haven't prayed. And then for me, like if I get a sense of loneliness, like I'm just like, when was the last time I really, now to me, because I've had to retrain my brain, again, which is what spirituality can do, is retrain us. Now it's to the point where I'm just like, why am I anxious? Oh, I haven't really had a real good holy hour in a while. I haven't really taken time to really contemplate. I've just kind of gone through my prayers and blown through them. But I really haven't taken time. It's the same thing like in a spouse. You get lonely with a spouse when you really don't have a good conversation in a while. But what, you see them all the time, right? But you really don't have anything of real depth. Same thing is true in our spiritual life. You will get a profound sense of loneliness if you don't have a deep relationship with God and you don't foster it. Angry. Again, to be angry, enraged, something which is very passionate, very different than irritated. Irritated is like a rash on the skin. It's something irritating. If you think that your faith is not going to be irritating, you're wrong. God gives us things which are irritating. God will irritate us because in irritation, he shows something's wrong that we need to change. Some people think that irritation is like, no, we shouldn't have. There are going to be things, your spouse will be irritating at times, and that's not their problem. It's yours. Okay? Depending on what you're irritated about. If you're irritated about sin, that's their problem. If it's irritated about just their behaviors and things like that, that's possibly more your problem. Very different than rage. Rage is a blind feeling, blind emotion. It comes from like, you see something, like your child gets hit in the store, you don't know why, and you go into a rage and you want to attack that person. Right? That's rage. More often than not, you see enraged parents coming in to talk to their teachers. Right? Rage, enraged parents. But rage is unthinking. That's why they're oftentimes irrational. You can't talk to an enraged person. The best thing to do with an enraged person is to walk away from them. You don't get into a rage with them, because then you just have two raging beasts. We're not called to just be blind feelings, okay? Which is what that fight and flight, that protective animal nature of ours, though we do have rage. Irritation, though, irate, very different than enraged, because you get irate over ideas, right? Enraged is all about just blind feeling and instinct. I get irate with something because it's actually something connected to brain, to the thoughts. I become irate upon your ideology. I get irate over things like that. And there are people who are like, why are you enraged? I'm not enraged. I'm thinking very clearly right now. An irate person oftentimes can become very cold and dispassionate, right? Because it's about an idea as opposed to just a feeling. Does this make sense? But it's what? Both of them are going to be connected to what? This kind of this aggressiveness. And neither of them actually has to be, because Jesus gets irate at times. You'll never see Jesus actually really get enraged. But you will see Jesus get irate. Many people think that they're angry when in fact they're hurt. And actually the only way they can express the hurt is through anger. But behind it, what they're actually really experiencing is some type of hurt. Until you get, actually anger is almost always a sign of hurt. So actually, if you're dealing with an angry person yourself, the real question is, why am I hurt? Does that make sense? People never, though, examine, I'm just angry. No, you're hurt. Why are you hurt? What caused the hurt? Was it something real or something illusionary? Was it something which was authentic or was it something inauthentic? Was it something which was shallow and which you really need to get over? Or was it something which was deep? Were you rejected? Or are you dejected? Are you angry because you got a momentary setback? You didn't get the job you wanted? Does this make sense? So hurt, again, can stem from rejection. It can also stem from being affronted. I'm affronted by your behaviors. I found your behaviors to be affronting. They offended my sense of decorum. But for the most part, you shouldn't really hold on to things which are affronting. Like, people do stupid stuff all the time. Affronting behavior should kind of be let go of. Because what? It's behavior. It's decorum. It's things like that. Does it have value? Yes. Does it have the greatest value in life? I mean, if you're around a person who's always an affronting person, who always offends people senselessly, and things like that, then you probably don't want to be around them forever. But can you let go of those things? Yes. It's affronting, but it's not really that big of a deal. Very different than outrage, which has to do with violations of justice, where you become outraged over the things that are going on in Syria. You become outraged over violations of the law, that all of the money got taken out of Social Security, and now we have no money in Social Security, that they got stolen. That's something that we can be outraged about. Why? Because it's a violation of justice. Does this make sense? Likewise, offended, your behavior, your actions, your words offended me. Well, guess what? Jesus is offensive. Jesus offends people. Does Jesus hurt them? Yes, he actually hurts them. He causes abrasions, irritations on the surface. Jesus never wounds people, though. But Jesus is offensive. He offends people's sense of what they think is right. Because what? He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He says, you must eat my body and drink my blood. And people found this offensive. What, right? You will, if you are going to be a good Christian, you are going to offend people. Having conflict is not a sin. Jesus had conflict. Jesus caused conflict. Jesus was the cause, the active cause of conflict in the Jewish community. Right? So much so that today is the day we celebrate where they got so offended and they got so irritated with him that they killed him. Right? But why? Because Jesus was aggressive. Jesus went out and said, you hypocrites. What? His words were offensive. He said, this is wrong. He said, Moses said, don't divorce your wife. I mean, Moses said you can divorce your wife, you give her a bill of sale. I say, if you look at a woman in lust, you're guilty of breaking the sixth commandment. The people who are looking in lust found this offensive. Evil finds truth offensive. That's what the psalm says, is that the evil person, the main cause for why evil people go after good ones, is because they find good people irritating. They find them offensive to what they think is right. This is where moral relativists will be highly offended by Christians. And so they'll say, you need to shut up. But we see that Jesus never shuts up. So being offensive, that's where people are like, you're offensive. I'm like, thank you. Actually, I say, what did you find offensive? Because if I rejected you, then I want to apologize. But if I said something which was true, it's not my problem. Does that make sense? It's actually where there's a lot of freedom that comes from not worrying about being offending people or being politically correct. But if you attack a person, Jesus attacks. But then the question becomes, why are you attacking the person? There are reasons to attack. You don't attack persons. You attack sins. You attack demons. You attack evil. But you don't attack people. As soon as things get personal. And this is actually what, ideally, law is actually supposed to be very good at. Lawyers can attack the argument, right? Or that's what they're supposed to be able to do, attack the argument without it ever getting personal. That's why two lawyers can get into an attack mode where they're both attacking the courtroom and they can go and have a beer afterwards. Because what? They're attacking, but it remains impersonal. It remains about the idea. We should be able to, and that's what actually in academic settings, you're meant to be able to attack ideas. And attack and grow and things like that. And if you can't do that, then many people will not learn. Because it's actually through this that we understand how to actually learn about certain things. But that's, many people though, but if you attack a person, it's actually bad. But many people will say, why did you attack me? You used the wrong word though. Many people, what actually is going on is you misunderstood me. Right? Many people feel like they're being attacked. When actually what the real problem is the person just doesn't understand. But they're what? This feels very hostile. Feels the person who's not emotionally intelligent uses the wrong word. They actually give the person an escape door out of not solving the problem. Because they're like, why did you attack me? Well, and then they won't listen to the fact. And then they realize, if they listen though, the person really doesn't understand. Right? I need to help them to understand. There are certain times though where the person is like, you don't understand. And the person's like, no, I do. I understand perfectly. The problem is not misunderstanding. I do understand, and I reject what you're saying. Right? Because I think it's wrong. Right? No, you misunderstand that. This is going to be good for our financial. No, I don't misunderstand. I reject it because it's going to put me in prison for embezzlement. Right? That's where people who play with like things and they think that they're misunderstanding it, but they play with evil, they end up in very bad situations, or they rationalize away bad things. Because what? Well, maybe I just don't understand why this person, maybe there's more to this over here, this evil thing which I was always taught as a youth was evil. Maybe I just don't understand it well enough. No, we do understand it to a certain extent. Does this make sense? So oftentimes actually using the proper language, because this is one which is used a lot, you abused me. Use the wrong language, and there might be a real problem in that the person abuse it always has to be met. But people oftentimes are not abused. Many people will be neglected or underappreciated. They'll experience the trauma, and the worst thing they can think about is abuse. Use the wrong language, though. A person who is neglecting and misunderstanding you is very different than a person who's abusing. Why? Because if the person, if you have an abuser and you say you're abusing me, then the person can't really say anything. But if they're not abusing you, they can say, I'm not abusing you, I didn't strike you, I didn't say anything, I didn't verbally assault you or anything like that. Use the right word, that you're underappreciating or you're neglecting your role and things like that. You know what the truth will do to a person? The truth will silence them. They'll either admit that, they'll either speak and they'll admit that they were wrong, or it will silence them. That's where people, like, you say the right word and people go quiet. Right? Because they have to go invulnerable. Because they don't want the truth to get in. Use the wrong word. People who cry abuse, and it's not really abuse, actually enable their spouses or enable people to continue doing whatever it is that they're doing. They use the right word, and you can actually find solutions to the problem. Does this make sense? And likewise, the last one, horny. Again, I know almost no female who wants to hear this word. I know many who are waiting to hear what? That from their spouse, or even a male with their spouse, I feel awakened when something is awakened within me that was not awakened before. Again, something more poetic. This is also something much more vulnerable. I know people who've been waiting for 25 years to hear, I desire you. Or I know many men who've been waiting for the entirety of their marriage to hear, I need you. But what? It entails vulnerability. It's not easy to express these, because if you express these, they might get hurt. That's why many people will only express the one on the left. So what? Aroused, again, I feel awakened, aroused, something has come up, enraptured versus lonely. Many people, when they think that they're experiencing horniness or this passionate sexual drive, what they actually are is that they're lonely, they're trying to fill the lonely with sex, right? People who are feeling lonely and they think, well, if I'm intimate with this person, then the loneliness will go away. And it goes away during the act, but as soon as the act is over, within about 2-3 minutes, they're lonely again, right? This is the definition of insanity, of doing things over and over again, expecting different results. Feel elevated out of myself, drawn, complete. Crappy line from Jerry Maguire actually has some truth to it. Excited. Okay. What? Excited? See, excitement is actually funny, because excitement is kind of a momentary thing versus ecstasia, which is a kind of a long-standing, timeless thing. Although it can be only for a few moments, but there's like a timeless. Excitement, though, animals get excited. And we get excited. Many people kill excitement in their marriages because they don't validate it. Because what? It is a superficial emotion. I get excited when I see people, but it's vulnerable. It kind of shows our playfulness. Many people who don't validate when the person gets excited and sees them, what they do is they crush it. And therefore, what their marriage has become without is without excitement, without fire, without eros, without passion. Because it is excitement. Excitement, sometimes we're like, well, this is a kind of a shallow feeling. It is a shallow feeling, but the shallow feelings are also authentic human ones. They're not something which we have to avoid. If we actually have a humble understanding of us, we can understand that, no, we have profound needs for depth, but we also have a profound needs for just kind of the shallow things as well. But people who likewise, because people who take, for instance, sex too seriously, or take their relationship too seriously, and there's never any playfulness or lightheartedness in it, is that they actually kill the excitement. Because actually, if you understand anything about the Holy Spirit wants to make us excited. Jesus gets excited. So all these things, inflamed, feel drawn to, all these things which actually express the authentic inner self. And there's hundreds more. This is where poetry, poetic expressions, metaphors, all that. But people, what? That takes more time. Takes more self-awareness. It also takes much more vulnerability. Much more difficult to do. When you look at, I think that I'm going to jump real quick because we're running out of time. men and women. Now, men do have a wonderful gift in being good compartmentalizers, which is actually good. It's not a bad thing to be able to compartmentalize. Because being single-minded, men, and this was true with my sister, my younger sister who's married, she found that when she was in the house, she would be doing like six or seven things at the same time. She'd be taking care of the kids, she'd be cleaning, she'd be making something, she'd be watching a movie, doing like five or six things at the same time. Okay, so when her husband came home, this was the first year of marriage, she was married a week after I was ordained. And so what she found is that every time that she came home, she would give her husband a honey-do list of all the things she needed help with, of like eight different things. And you know what her husband would do? He'd look at it, and he'd throw it in the garbage can, and he'd go and sit down and drink a beer. Okay, now women, what would you do with that if your husband did that? You'd, like my sister, you'd be really angry, right? What she found, though, if I remember correctly, she went and asked her mother-in-law. She's like, what do I do? Because she was really causing frustration for her. She's like, what do I do with this? And so she was like, just give him one thing to do at a time. Right? And she's like, just give him one. She's like, but I have all these other things. She's like, he's only going to be able to do one thing at a time anyways. Give him one thing to do at a time. He'll be good at doing that. And then give him another one. And then after he's done with that, give him another one. So that's really what she started doing. And she found that he was actually more than happy to respond to that. He was more than happy to do one thing because then he could do it with excellence. He wasn't overwhelmed by all these different things. There is a difference. Now, some women are like that. Some men can be like that. Again, but typically speaking, men will have a single-minded devotion, single-mindedness, not simple-minded, but they become single-minded, almost intensely focused on one thing and one thing alone, right? Now, sometimes it can be on themselves. Sometimes it can be on sex. Sometimes it can be on their hobby. Sometimes it can be on what, where everything they block out. Have you ever seen your husband where he blocks out everything? And just blocks everything out? It's what I call going into the heart of stone. It's what men just go into and they block out. And I'm actually really good at it. I can be in the middle of like six sisters who are all yelling and screaming. I can just block it all out. So I focus on the one thing that I want to focus on. Go into my fortress of solitude like Superman, right? So what? This single-mindedness is actually a great gift. It can be misused and it can be selfish. But just as where you'll find that women, typically speaking, being more complex and more complicated in terms of being able to do lots of different things at the same time, men, if you have a person who does one thing really well at a time, it's one of the reasons why men, typically speaking, have always understood to be leaders in war. Because you don't want complexity. You want single devotion. Single, simple devotion to one thing. Let's get the job done. I don't care about all the other things. Get it done. Now, that can also sometimes leave trails of body in the wake, which is a danger. But it actually also gets things done and it solves conflicts actually much better than overcomplicating conflicts. Emotions can overcomplicate conflicts. And this is where actually the two sexes complement each other. Because in that, there's a time for peace and there's a time for war. This is also why, typically speaking, the actual thing that people will say about men is that men tend to be fixers. Women tend to make people feel good. That's why women will create oftentimes circles of like groups where everyone gets listened to and heard. And what do men create? Hierarchies, pyramids, where stuff gets done. And there's sometimes it's built upon dead bodies, right? I'm just saying, it's true. What? But it gets things done. They're very effective types of things, but they're oftentimes not very personal ones. But within this, there is a time because we do live in a battle. We live in spiritual war. It's interesting when you look at the statistics on children who stay in the children who participate and stay within a religion after they leave the house. If both parents are involved on a spiritual level, 93% of children will stay within the religion. It doesn't matter what the religion is. If neither party is involved, 3% will stay in the religion. If the mother is the spiritual head of the house and the father is spiritually absent, 18 to 30% of children will stay within the religion. If the father is the spiritual head of the house and the mother is spiritually absent, does anyone know what it is? 70%. 70% of children will stay in the religion if the father is spiritually present in the house and the mother is spiritually absent. That's just the raw statistics. And it doesn't matter if you're Catholic, doesn't matter if you're Jewish. Again, Jews, Catholics, there's a spiritual leadership in the household, which actually is very good and very effective. When men are actually engaged in spirituality, it's been proven that your likelihood of children staying in is much higher. Like I said, if you have both parties, which is ideal, 93%. But still, you have that 70%, because what? There is a leadership role, but a leadership not of domination, but of service. That's what Christ comes and shows, is the leadership of service. Because men typically try to fix. Anyone, I don't know if you've seen this clip. I'll show this, though. So, one point, big qualitative difference. Funny thing is, they're both right, they're both wrong. It's a time and a place to fix things. There's a time and a place to listen. Even in psychology, this was what was called, Carl Rogers called what was person-centered therapy. He understood that if you were to surround a person with a loving environment and that they felt loved and cherished, that actually most people were able to fixing their own problems. That's why they put you on the couch, he'd listen to you, he'd just reflect back. And do that. Because if people feel cherished and loved, but sometimes, and there's value to that, there's sometimes where actually people don't want to be fixed, they just want to be listened to and understood and loved. There's also times, though, where people don't have the tools necessary to find the solutions to the problem because they truly are lost. There's a time and place to fix things, which is actually what men typically are very good at, is fixing things. There's a time and place to listen. That's where it takes wisdom to understand what type of situation you're dealing with. But, and we're going to close here today. Relationships are built upon what we have in common, but also what we don't have in common. And love equals communication. This is why, especially like the five love languages and tools like this help people to understand the greater complexity of emotional as well as showing and exhibiting love. But it also has to be something which is reciprocated. Two parties which are both equally engaged, and two parties which are engaged who are very different, who complement the other. Because if we were exactly the same, there's no complementarity. There's nothing that the other person has to give to the other person. Only if we're different do we have something to give to the other party. That's why two persons of the same gender don't have the same to give that two persons of opposite gender would. But also trust. Relationship without trust is like a car without gas. You can stand it all you want, but it's not going anywhere. And trust is very difficult to build, but it's also very easy to lose. Because it also demands honesty. So communication, vulnerability, honesty, which is built upon truth. Truth, not just what's going on in our physical life, but truth in the emotional life, truth in the spiritual life, truth in our physical life, truth in everything. A complete openness. What's worth living for? What's worth dying for? What's worth suffering for? And it's actually, this is what Sophocles, an ancient Greek philosopher, said, it's better to fail with honor than to succeed by fraud. And so if we're not willing to be honest, then we're going to have huge problems, which is why honesty is also something which will entail conflicts and problems, if you're truly honest. But also, it demands respect. Like cats and dogs, men and women are very much the same, but in other ways, we are entirely different. And in these differences, you will find that they complement. If you were entirely strong and you had no weaknesses, you would not need anyone. And you would actually be lonely. You'd be alone. See, it's actually in our weaknesses that we find actually complementarity. And so where man is strong, woman is weak, and where woman is strong, man is weak. And this is actually God's design from the very beginning. Adam is lonely. He's incomplete. until Eve shows up. And the same would be true of Eve, which is actually what Satan tempts Eve with, is that you don't need Adam. Why? You can be God. God doesn't need anything. You don't need anyone else, right? So within this, this is the principle of what we call in relationship, we build it not just upon equality and not just upon equity. We build relationship between the sexes upon equity, which involves giving everyone what they need in order to enjoy healthy and happy lives, as well as equality, giving people the same things insofar as that they are the same. Food, hydration, shelter, we all have an equal need. But love, not always exactly the same. We don't have the beginning, same beginning point. We have the same ending point, but not the same beginning point. Equality aims at, and here's an example of equality, for fair selection, because people are like, to have justice in relationships, you have to have, everyone has to be treated exactly the same. Okay? Can you see the little cartoon? For a fair selection, everyone has to take the same exam. Please climb the tree. Okay? So does that make the monkey the best? Well, no, the elephant's going to rip the tree apart and we'll destroy the test. Okay, goldfish is going to be very unhappy. What? Does that make one better than the other? No, they're different. And actually, just because they're different doesn't mean that one is better, that one contains more justice than the other. So when you look at relationships, equity involves giving people what they need. It evaluates the differences in beings, the difference in relationships, and how we try to give the person what they need. We don't give people exactly the same thing unless they have exactly the same need. Food, hydration, yes. Love, no. Discipline, no. If you discipline your children exactly the same, you will actually do harm to them. You have to take into account their differences, because if one of their love languages is, one child's love language is physical touch, and you spank them, you're going to do damage. If one of their love languages is verbal affirmation and you assault them with language, you're harsh to them, they will be more easily wounded than if the person with physical touch. That's why you have to change your discipline to effectively discipline and to show them that they are loved, but they also need guidance. People, that's where children are like, you're not treating me fairly. No, we're not treating you fairly. That's a good thing. Because God doesn't treat us fairly. God gives to some more and to others less, but he gives everyone an overflowing of what they need. And the relationships, a lot of the problems in the modern world, which we're going to come to, comes to this problem right here, is people who say you have to be one or the other. Men and women have to be treated either entirely with equity, or men and women have to be treated entirely with equality, as opposed to balancing these two. Does this make sense? Because justice, if you look at the scales of justice, what is justice scaling or balancing? I would say that what justice is scaling and balancing is both principles. Both principles are the scales on the weight. But we're going to pick up there next week, so let's go ahead and close with a prayer. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time to come together today. We ask you, Lord, to send down your Spirit in abundance upon us. As we grow in our understanding of relationship and of love, and of where you're speaking to us, we just ask you, Lord, to open up any fruits from today which we need to hear, which will be helpful and fruitful in our life. Just ask you, Lord, to keep all of us safe and open up for those of who are going to the Eucharist a greater awareness of the presence of your Son and his love in the Eucharist. We ask all this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Peace, Christ, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen.